Good morning, everyone. Well, I'm going to give a brief talk here about how groundwater interacts with lakes and streams. And so I'll be covering some groundwater basics, maybe basic for many people, but not everyone, a little bit about stream hydrogeology, and then I'll finish up with how pumping affects, how pumping from wells affects streams and lakes. I wanted to point out a couple of good publications, both from the U.S. Geological Survey. One of these is called Groundwater and Surface Water, a Single Resource. And this makes the point that groundwater and surface water are really quite intimately related and really need to be managed and understood as a single resource. And the you can download this book at this website. And then a second one is this recent publication, Circular 1376 from the U.S. Geological Survey about groundwater and stream flow depletion by wells and understanding and managing the effects of groundwater. And much of the information that I think we'll all be presenting today is in these two books. So to start out, what is groundwater? Well, that's groundwater is any of the water filling the pores, cracks, fractures, and other interstices in geologic materials below the land's surface. We usually think of groundwater as being in the saturated zone. So the saturated zone is the zone of the earth where all the pores and spaces in the rocks or soil or sand and gravel are filled with water. And the top of that is called the water table. Above the water table, we have the unsaturated zone where the pores are only partially filled with water, although there is water in that area. We need to talk about a little bit about the water cycle, remembering that all water begins as precipitation, snow, or rain falling on the land surface, percolating or infiltrating into the ground. Much of that water runs off, becomes runoff, and much of that transpires or evapotranspires back to the atmosphere. A smaller percentage percolates into the ground and eventually becomes crosses the water table and becomes part of the groundwater flow system. Groundwater moves through the groundwater flow system through aquifers. Aquifers are geologic units that are permeable enough to transport and transmit and store significant quantities of groundwater. Some of this groundwater is eventually going to discharge to usually a surface water body like a lake or a stream or a wetland. Some of it gets intercepted and discharges into wells. Groundwater moves in three dimensions. This diagram is most relevant for humid climates where the water table is a subdued representation of the topography, but we have higher water levels under hills and lower water levels near the stream. If we start taking that apart, we see that groundwater moves laterally from these divides on the tops of the water table to the low points, the streams. It also moves vertically in flow paths that go down and then back up to discharge to a surface water point. And the divides in the groundwater flow system are called groundwater divides. So groundwater moves in three dimensions. So let's get to some streams. Groundwater is important for streams and lakes because it often sustains streams, lakes, and wetlands. And so the groundwater flows through the groundwater flow system, ends up discharging to a surface water body. The picture on the right shows that there's often a zone called the hyporheic zone right under a stream or a lake where there's a lot of biochemical and geochemical reactions go on. That's a very active biological and chemical zone. A lot of transformations in chemistry happen right there. I don't have more time to talk about that today, but just be aware that there's a lot of, in addition to just flow, there's a lot of chemical and biological interactions that go on between groundwater and surface water. Streams can be gaining and losing, meaning that as streams flow along, if in the upper left here, this is called a gaining stream because groundwater is flowing into the stream and maintaining its flow and really increasing its flow. In contrast, the stream on the lower left is a losing stream because you can see the water table is basically below the level of the stream or the river, and so water leaks out of the stream into the groundwater system, and so that stream eventually loses water. And the diagram on the right is just a plot of stream flow versus distance down a stream, showing if you went through a losing reach, how you would get a change, a slight decrease in stream flow as you went through that losing part of the stream, where maybe a well near the stream is causing it to be losing stream by pulling water out of it. Sometimes streams and lakes can become disconnected from the groundwater system, meaning that there's a unsaturated zone. The water table drops below the bottom of the surface water body, and so we have an unsaturated zone there. Often there's a mound in the water table below that, as shown in the upper left diagram. And there's still water moving from the stream to the groundwater system, but it's moving in the unsaturated zone in an unsaturated way. The lower diagram shows where the system has become completely disconnected. In fact, the stream has become dry. So here's a very, and this could be probably more common in the more arid parts of the country. A little bit about lakes. Lakes are often, particularly here in Wisconsin, in the humid parts of the country, outcrops of the water table. In other words, they're a low point in the landscape, and that's where the water table appears at the surface. Lakes are dynamic systems. There's a lot of groundwater exchange between lakes and the groundwater system. So there's usually three different possibilities, as shown on the right. Upper, we have a lake where groundwater is discharging into the lake all the time, all around it. Second, or middle diagram, water is leaving the lake. And the third is what we call a flow-through lake. Groundwater is flowing into one side of the lake and out the other side of the lake. And some groundwater actually passes beneath the lake. And we see all these situations pretty commonly in groundwater systems. A little bit about base flow. Groundwater sustains streams like this trout stream shown on the lower left by maintaining base flow. The groundwater discharge is the reason that streams flow cool and steadily even during the hot parts of the year. Here in Wisconsin, we have a lot of great trout streams, particularly in the southwest part of our state, that are flow all the time, even in the middle of the summer when it hasn't rained for days or weeks. And that's because there's a lot of groundwater discharge. Here's the upper left here, we have a stream hydrograph with lots of peaks corresponding to various storms and so forth. But you can see that the base flow, the black line, is what is being sustained by groundwater. We can do things with this sort of information by making a base flow index of looking at streams that have higher percentages of base flow versus this transient storm flow and trying to map that out. Here's a map of Wisconsin, and the bluer areas have higher total base flow. And then when we overlay that with where our trout streams are, you can see how important something like groundwater and base flow are to our trout fishing industry. It's because the trout streams correspond to where we have these high base flow conditions. Now a little bit about how our pumping groundwater can affect streams. Pumping from an aquifer that's near a stream or a surface water body can cause two things: drawdown or lowering of water levels near the well, and a reduction of groundwater flow to nearby features, a reduction of this natural discharge. And here's a fairly famous diagram just showing a stream and an aquifer and a recharge area up here, groundwater flowing to the stream. And we put a well in there, and the well has a little cone of depression around it. And you can see by what the arrows are doing that well starts to diminish the flow to the stream. And if we increase the pumping from Q1 to Q2 here, we even can reverse flow. So a well near a stream always is going to have some sort of impact on the stream, and the amount of that impact will depend on the distance from the stream and the amount of pumping from the well and so forth. And I think Bill Alley will talk a little bit more about that. Now, a little bit about the water budget. Remember that a water budget is kind of like a bank balance, and everything has to balance, all the inflows and outflows of water. And hydrogeologists use mostly computer models to do this water budget accounting. In many parts of the world, when we think of a water budget deficit, that deficit is going to be expressed as a decrease in flow to our surface water features, lakes, streams, and wetlands, because you don't get something for nothing in the groundwater world. Anytime we pump a well and take water out of the ground, that water is water that would have ended up somewhere else, usually in a lake, stream, or wetland. And scientist named Seward, who's a South African, has illustrated this rather well, I think, with the concept of the looking at groundwater as sort of a bucket here, where you have, think of this as an aquifer, this diagram on the left with this full of water. And we often see this with aquifers. We have people have a whole lot of water in their aquifer, and yet a little bit of pumping can have a deleterious effect on ecological resources. And this is because not all that water is really equally available. Some of the water, the very deep water, is often what's called physically unabstractable here, or it's just hard or too expensive or physically too difficult to get to. So even though the water's there, it's hard to use. And then we have water that's maybe in the middle of the system here that we can pump out for use and for human use or for agricultural use. And that's water that can be consumed. But right at the top, we have what's often called the ecological reserve. This is the water that would have been the first water to discharge to a lake, stream, or wetland, or spring. And this, and if we go to the right and we start pumping that, we can see that that's the first water that gets depleted. And so the first thing we see if we start depleting an aquifer is decreased discharge to these surface water features. And that's can be a troubling thing. So there are a few misconceptions, and this is from that USGS circular about groundwater and stream flow depletion. First, the misconception is the total development of groundwater resources from an aquifer system is safe or sustainable at rates to their average rate of recharge. There was an old, almost a myth of that if as long as you didn't use more water than was recharged, you were okay. But the problem with that idea is that it doesn't account for the water that's needed for to sustain the ecology or for what's called environmental services, the water that sustains the space flow. So that needs to be accounted for. The second misconception is that depletion is dependent on the rate and direction of water movement in the aquifer. That's really not true. It's more the decline in head or the decline in pressure in the aquifer is going to go out in all directions. Third, depletion stops when pumping ceases. That's not true either, and that's because of the storage properties that I think Bill is going to talk about in a minute. And finally, if we have a confining unit or an aquitard in our system, there was some thought that pumping below that aquitard is going to eliminate any groundwater depletion, and that's not completely true either. You may get some delay in the depletion, but it's not going to eliminate it. And then so finally, to finish up here, my main points today are that groundwater and surface water are well connected and should be thought of as a single resource. We can't really manage them differently. All water comes from somewhere, which seems obvious, but we need to remember that the water balance is critical for management decisions, and anytime you perturb the water balance, you're changing something. Groundwater discharge becomes a base flow and sustains the flow in streams and then lakes. And pumping from wells near streams can reduce stream flow, and these impacts depend on pumping rates and the local hydrogeologic setting. I think Bill and Thomas will talk more about this. And that's it for me, Charlotte.